No, I'm kidding. Making more of a practice of taking the time of rest that he needs. So I'm glad that he's doing that. So I'm filling in. And he did send me a few announcements that I have this morning. So Wednesday night prayer, every single Wednesday night here, back in the room there. Just some time to, pray over our church and seek God's wisdom through everything we're going through. So Wednesday night prayer, that's at 7 o'clock every single week. We also have men's breakfast coming up next month, December 16th. So please come out to that if you get the chance. It's always a good time. We have a lot of good food, but also definitely share some good words and just an encouraging time to hang out as men. So if you get the chance, December 16th, come on out for that. And then we also have the Women's Christmas Brunch coming up. So this is December 19th, 10 a.m. The sign-up is in the lobby. No. What did I say? Yeah, December 9th. Thank you. December 9th, 10 a.m. Yeah. All right, got it. December 9th. Sign up in the lobby. Any other info on that, Sheila?
No, it's all on the sign-up sheet. They can see me if they have questions.
Okay, all right. And then we also have our Christmas Eve service coming up. Thanksgiving is way behind us already, and we are well into the Christmas season, so we're just going to be talking about all of this now. December 24th is going to be our Christmas Eve service. Now, that happens to be a Sunday, so what we're going to do is we're going to meet regular time Sunday morning, 10 a.m., but it's going to play out a little bit like our Christmas Eve services have in the past. So if there is something you would like to contribute to the service, be it a song, the kids are doing a play, maybe there's a reading you want to do, or something along those lines, come see John. He's putting everything together. So we'd love to get a lot of participation for something like that. It's always a really good time. And then Christmas Eve, like in the evening, we'll just leave that time open, give you time to spend with your families and all of that. So all we're doing for Christmas Eve this year is 10 a.m. Sunday morning here. If you want to do something, let John know, and cutoff for that is going to be December 17th. So if you want to be part of it, just let John know before the 17th. Does that make sense? I think it was kind of confusing last week, but hopefully everyone gets it. One other thing, Ethan told me that his grandma had a bit of a mini stroke, I guess is what we're calling it, so she's not doing very well. His dad, Russ, is not with us today because he's waiting on a call to see if he needs to fly down to Florida and be with her. We don't know how this is all going to pan out, so we want to pray for him. Anything else this morning that anyone would like prayer for that we can lift up before we get started? All right. Well, let's pray and then jump into this. So, Father, thank you so much for this church. We thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made, God, so we can come before your throne. Father, we lift up Ethan's grandma to you this morning. We don't know what's going on. Russ doesn't know what's going on. And we're just interceding for her before you, God. We pray for her health. We pray for peace for the family, God, as they navigate this time. Father, I pray for the sermon ahead of us. God, I really believe that you've got something special for us this morning in your word. I pray for clarity, God, as I speak, that what you would want to be spoken would come out of my mouth and nothing else. Father, I just ask for your spirit, your presence in this time. We give you all the honor, all the glory. Amen. So I'm sure he'll listen later. He tends to do that. So I'm going to thank Russ again for the opportunity to let me come up here. He just kind of trusts me to just stand on this stage and say whatever I want. So that being said, I pulled a couple inspirational quotes from Facebook, and we're just going to preach off of those this Sunday and get you all out of here with a warm, fuzzy feeling. No, I'm kidding. it was funny. He was talking to me about the announcements yesterday, and he was like, so So by the way, I mean, just out of curiosity, like, what are you preaching on? I gave him kind of the rundown. It's been approved. Don't worry. But no fuzzy messages today, unfortunately. No warm, fluffy feelings. It's a tough one, but we've been having a lot of those going through the book of Hebrews. It's been hitting me. I mean, like, just week after week, it's just like, bam, bam, bam. And we're actually going to take a little break from the book of Hebrews today, but it really is important, I believe, to not shy away from the corners of the Bible that make us uncomfortable, that we don't understand. And one thing I've always appreciated about Pastor Russ's preaching is he just dives headlong into that, and he doesn't really care what we think. He just says it, and I think that's beautiful. So the reason, however, that that's so important, I mean, it is an incredible responsibility as a communicator, as a leader in the church, to be able to share the truth even when it's hard, to be able to bring that that word even though it may feel cold. Because we want to base our faith on the solid rock. I mean, we sang that on that last song. It was really hit me on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand, right? But rocks are cold and uncomfortable, and however, they are unmoving. And that's why no matter where you are in your life, I guarantee you a storm is coming. If anyone hasn't realized yet, I hate to break the news to you, it is nearly December. The winter storms are coming. They're on their way. I feel like usually like 3 to 4 times a winter, we just really get hit with like a big old snowstorm. And the kind that you got to shovel, you know, 10 inches, 8 inches, whatever, right? And then I feel like maybe like every like 8 to 10 years or more, we get hit with like a really big storm, like one that we like talk about for years and years. And so I, for those of you who don't know, am in the building profession, and code enforcement requires us to build our roofs to handle those type of storms. The 2 to 3 times a year, even the one storm that happens every 8 to 10 years, we're required to build these roof systems to handle that type of pressure. Now, most of the year round, all right, it's completely unnecessary, way overbuilt. But for those times that's really, really tough, you're glad that you have a very solid system in place. And so that's what I want to prepare you for today with this sermon. See, the literal and the metaphorical storms are on their way. The wind is going to swirl. And so that's why the truth, even when it's difficult, is good to hear, because it gives you that solid foundation for those difficult times. See, I've seen people not dig into the truth. I've seen people just focus on what makes them comfortable, and then something terrible happens, and they shake their fist at the sky, they blame God, and they walk away. Or I've seen other people deny God altogether and say, if God is good, why would he let bad things happen? Why do these storms even happen? Why do these bad things even take place? And in order for this sermon, in order for this message to do any good at all, I need all of you to admit something I've had to admit, which is that when bad things happen, we ask why. Right? Can we all, like, can I get a collective nod out of this, right? Can we all agree that when bad things happen, we ask why, right? Why? And it's kind of part of like our human nature, right? We're constantly searching for that truth, trying to understand everything that's going on around us. I mean, we even just start with the natural world, like why do the leaves change color in the fall? Why do bee stings hurt so much? Why does Jovi keep waking up at night? Ugh, why? Right? So many questions. Or why is the grass green, the sky blue, right? We ask why. It's who we are. It's why the human society has become what it is today, because we seek to understand. We need to know why. We believe that there's a reason for every outcome in life. We're kind of obsessed with cause and effect. If I do this, then this will happen, right? We think in our minds, if I work out, if I clean up my diet a little bit, I'm going to lose fat and gain muscle. If we think to ourselves, if I put a new roof on my house, then it won't leak, right? If I work hard, then I'll succeed. Cause and effect. If I do this, then this will happen, right? So there's kind of these expectations that we walk around with, right? If I live a holy life, God will bless me. If I train my kids up and really pour into them, then one day they're going to return the favor. We think this way. And we're constantly creating these systems in our minds. If I give this input, this is what I get out. If I do this, then I get this. It's kind of like a mechanic does. So I know we've got a lot of great mechanics here with us this morning. I know Britt can do some damage, and so can Scott and Mike. I mean, there's a lot of these guys, right? Okay, who know about vehicles. I am not one of them. So what do you do? If something's not working, you got to ask why, all right? And so then maybe you start eliminating these variables. Okay, it's not that, it's not this, it's not that, right? And the worst part is when you find something that you're like, well, like maybe that's the problem, right? Like, all right, well, I guess we'll just replace it and see if that does it, right? It's great when you can really be like, oh yeah, man, like look at that. Like that was definitely the problem. Let's replace that, let's fix it. For me, it wasn't with vehicles. It was fixing the electric fence growing up. So you would get the little fence tester out, right? Or if you couldn't find that thing, you just do it the old-fashioned way, right? Yeah, right? So you're trying to find, all right, is this fence, where's the short in the electrical current, all right? So you unhook that gate, All right, let's test it again. All right, we got electric to here, so it's not that section, okay? So let's try the next section. Is it this? All right, hook it up. Okay, we've got a problem here. Let's really comb through this area and see if we can find the problem. We're always looking for solutions. So when bad things happen to good people, we question what's wrong. Where's the broken thing? What am I missing here? I thought that if I did what I was supposed to do, what God was leading me into. I thought that if I stepped into ministry, if I married this person, or if I went to school here, or if I decided to work there, that I was going to receive this or that. What's going on? What's broken here? What am I not understanding about this system? Nonetheless, unpleasant things continue to happen to us, whether we know why they happen or not. And so the title of my sermon today is The Unpleasant Truth. And what I want to bring to you is the truth about the unpleasant stuff that happens to us. And who better to ask, what better book of the Bible to go to than the book of Job? And there was a collective groan. No, all right. If you want to leave now, you can, but I like the book of Job. That guy, he had some very interesting stuff to share. One of the oldest manuscripts ever found, one of the oldest original documents in the Bible is the book of Job. We don't exactly know when the events of Job happened. We just know that they did. Sometime in the Old Testament is really the frame that we can give this. So what happened to Job? For those of you who don't know the story, very, very tragic event, probably the most tragic you could possibly imagine, but Job was a very godly man. He did everything God asked him to do. He lived an upright life. The Bible actually calls him blameless. And God blessed him. How many of us know that if we live a holy life, there's definitely blessings associated with that? Job was experiencing that. He had abundant wealth here on earth, countless herds of livestock, many servants. He had 7 children, and really just all together, you know, worshiped regularly. What happened one day, all in one day, and the way that the Bible writes it is almost in the span of a few hours, it seems, where a servant comes running up to Job and says, I was managing your flocks in this area, and raiders came out of the hills and took everything. I'm the only one that escaped to tell you. And another servant, similar story. I was managing these herds, and this tragic thing happened, and I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. And servant after servant, everything he had, gone, 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 gone. The last servant comes up. It says, your children were all feasting together in a house. The wind came in from the desert, collapsed all the corners, fell in on them, and they're all gone. Tragic, tragic thing. So here Job is, living a holy life, doing what he's supposed to do, and in the midst of an incredibly unpleasant time, a very tragic moment for him. See, the system that we have made up in our minds is that if we honor God with our lives, he will reward us. See, one of the ways that God blesses his people is he provides for us, right? Even to the point where we're full and overflowing, we have abundance, right? God likes to pour out his blessing, his wealth on his children. So we look at that system that we know in our minds, right? Like, I want to walk in God's blessing. This is common preaching in our church even. We look at that system, we say, what the heck? Job was a good guy. Why did all these bad things happen to him? Well, in the book of Job, there's three different responses to the awful, awful tragedies that happened to Job. See, on top of all those things that happened to him, he was also, his health was taken from him as well. He was covered in boils and I don't know about you guys, but like, I can deal with a lot. But like, if I'm sick and then I also have to deal with a lot, it just multiplies everything else that's going on around me. So Job really has this terrible mix of everything. But I want to share with you three responses to Job's calamity. And the first one is his wife. Now, I think it's kind of interesting, and maybe I'm reading too far into this, but God takes seemingly everything of value from Job's life, but he leaves his wife. Now, I don't know if that says something about necessarily Job's relationship with his wife or like where her frame of mind was or whatever, but she did not seem very helpful. We'll read in Job chapter 2, starting in verse 8. It says that Job scraped his skin with a piece of broken pottery as he sat among the ashes. Ouch. His wife said to him, "Are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Curse God and die." Not like, hey, can I get you a glass of water? Like, do you need a blanket? Like, do you want some chicken noodle soup? It was curse God and die. And I think the most interesting part of her response is in those four words, curse God and die. Curse God, meaning give up your eternal life. The system's broken. What you thought you were doing, the input, you know, that you were giving, striving towards, living a holy life, doing what you were called to do, you're not getting out what you should be getting out. Clearly something's wrong here. God's probably not even real. Curse him, and then on top of that, die. Give up your eternal life, give up your physical life. It's not worth it. Don't even try. I haven't been to that extreme, but I've felt that before. Why does it even matter? Why do I even try? What's even the point if all these bad things are just going to continue to happen to me? I'm sick of it. There's not even a point in trying. So Job's wife says, the system's broken, give up, curse God and die. Very interesting response in just a few words there. But there's a few other people in the book of Job as well. And they're Job's friends. And these guys, I don't really feel like they're great friends. Maybe they just didn't get it. But there's about 9 chapters in the book of Job where his friends are responding to everything that had happened to him. And his three friends are Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. I did have to read those. I can't remember those. And I'm not going to read all 9 chapters. I'll give you kind of just in a nutshell pretty much what they said. So there's Job just in the ashes, scraping away on his skin. I don't really understand how scraping it with broken pottery is soothing in any way, but that was Job, I guess. So there's Job in his ashes, mourning the death of his children, the loss of all of his possessions, trying to understand and grapple with what God's doing. And they basically sit down and just said, "Hey, Job, buddy, listen here. you're living in sin. This is why all this is happening to you. You must have done something wrong, Job, because the way that God's treating you, the only way that this makes sense is he's punishing you. He's trying to weed something out of you. There's sin in your life. There's something that you've done wrong that God's trying to move you past. And Job wasn't buying it. See, Job knew that he was living a holy life. He knew that his walk was righteous, that his relationship with God was tight, it was close. Job's friends were convinced, however, that if he would just repent, if he would turn back to God and say, "God, I'm sorry. Where's the sin in my life? Where have I come up short? What am I doing that's rebellious, right?" And why would this thought even come into these guys' heads? Well, because God has done this in the past. Especially with the Israelite people, where if they're living in sin, if they're worshiping idols, if they're living a type of life that doesn't honor God, wham, seen it happen before. And it's totally within God's right to do that. But this wasn't the case with Job. See, if you read in the beginning of the book of Job, it is very clearly stated by God himself that Job was a righteous man. He was living a holy life. That he was, in fact, blameless. So Job's friends, not very helpful. At least those three. There's a fourth one. We'll get to him later. But we're gonna read the third response to Job's calamity, right? So the first one was, the system's broken. Curse God, die, just give up. It's not worth it. The second one was Job's friends, which is that, "Job, you must be living in sin. This is some sort of major punishment that's finally caught up to you." And the third response is Job's, which is the one I want to focus on today. And we're going to read in chapter 2, verse 10. After Job's wife had told him to curse God and die, Job replied, "You talk like a foolish woman. Should we accept only good things from the hand of God and never anything bad?" So in all this, Job said nothing wrong. And I had to read this a couple times because when I first came into this book to start to do this study, because this is what I believe God wanted me to share on, I thought for sure it was what I've read many other places in the Bible, which is like, God is using tragedy, difficulty, hardship to build our character, to teach us something, to grow us. But even more, that it's not necessarily God who's doing those things. He allows it to happen. But it says here, should we accept only good things from the hand of God and never anything bad? Never anything bad from the hand of God? And I was like, what? Bad things from the hand of God? That doesn't make sense in my mind. Job lost everything he valued on earth. See, then he lost his health on top of that. And there was actually two attacks from the enemy. One was on all of his possessions and his children, and the second was on his health. And there's these interesting interactions in the book of Job between God and the devil. Apparently they talk. And the devil, God brings up Job to the devil and said, have you seen my servant Job? And the devil says, let me test him, and I'm going to show you that he'll turn against you. And so the devil brings all that difficulty on Job. And we read in Job chapter 2, actually, verse 3, it says, then the Lord asked Satan, have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil, and he has maintained his integrity, even though you urged me, speaking of God, this is God talking, you urged me to harm him without cause. And then I was really like, what the heck? Like, am I reading this wrong? Like, I started looking at different translations and digging deeper into kind of the word study on this. Like, what does this mean? Like, God is harming one of his children? That doesn't make a lot of sense. And I guess God knew this. And so I find myself around a campfire Great place to talk about things you don't understand in the Bible. And it was the night before opening day of regular gun season. And I'm hanging out with my dad and my brother. And we're just kind of conversing back and forth. They were curious as to what I was preaching on. And as I'm kind of sharing with them sort of about Job and how I was like I don't really get this, like how it says that God was the one who caused this. It wasn't the devil who went and did this. It says that God said, even though you urged me to harm him without cause, I was like, I don't understand, I don't get it. And Eric just goes, oh, well, that's like the man who was born blind that Jesus healed. And I was like, wait, that makes a lot of sense. So let's go there. John chapter 9. Thanks for the heads up, Eric. And we're going to start reading in verse 1. It says, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been born blind from birth. Rabbi, his disciples asked him, why was this man born blind? They're sounding just like Job's friends here. Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins? Jesus says, it was not because of his sins or his parents' sins, Jesus answered. This happened so that the power of God could be seen in him. See, this man, from the day he was born, couldn't see. And I know there's some people like that today, but nobody that I know personally, and I certainly can't imagine that. Hardship, difficulty, unpleasantness of going through life not being able to see for the sole purpose of God to be glorified. It's a different way of looking at it. See, the disciples were looking at this man's life just sitting there on the street corner begging because he had no other way to make money. And they're thinking to themselves, there's a lot of benefits to living a righteous life. This doesn't seem very beneficial. This doesn't seem like this man's just walking in blessing. Clearly, he must have sinned somewhere. Another person I found is actually Noah. In Genesis chapter 6, he's described as being blameless. Same word used to describe Job. But look what happened to him. Can you imagine spending most of your life building an ark, taking care of all of those animals, being washed away in the uncertainty of a massive global flood, and then being set down on a mountaintop, the only remaining people on the entire face of the planet? That's tough. That's difficult. That's hardship. And not because of anything that Noah did wrong necessarily, not because of anything that he sinned or anything like that. It was just God using righteous people to do difficult things for his glory. See, Job did not experience this hardship because God was trying to improve his character. I mean, so often we think of like Romans chapter 5 where it says, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. That's what I think of when I go through suffering, right? God must have a reason for this. He's trying to grow something out of me. And while that is the case sometimes, that's not the case here. And it's not always the case for us. If this is our only outlook on adversity, that God's trying to groom us to be better Christians, if our only perspective when it comes to the unpleasant things in life is that God's trying to work on us, then maybe we're actually more selfish than we thought. See, what if the adversity you're going through has nothing to do with improving you? Instead, it has everything to do with bringing God glory. And that one made me be quiet for a little bit. It's not about you. It's not about Job. He had to figure that out. Job chapter 1, starting in verse 20. Job stood up, tore his robe in grief. This was after all these servants came and said, I'm the only one who survived to tell you the bad news. I'm the only one who survived to tell you. I'm the only one who survived to tell you. Job stood up, tore his robe in grief. Then he shaved his head and fell to the ground in worship. He said, I came naked from my mother's womb. and I'll be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin by blaming God. Truth is hard. Job knew that God gave him everything he had, every possession, every child. And that's because of how it didn't matter in Job's mind. He didn't think about if he had sinned, if he had fallen short, what had gone wrong. He knew that God was sovereign and could do whatever he wants because he's God. I can't even begin to try to understand everything that God's doing. And neither could Isaiah in chapter 55, verses 8 and 9. He's speaking the words of the Lord here. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. See, just because we can't understand the reason why unpleasant things are happening doesn't mean there is no reason. It just means that there's a being in charge who has a much grander view, a much wider scope, and he will receive glory one way or the other. So you may go your entire life without getting a reason for why some of this stuff happens, but you just need to trust him. See, here's where it really got me, was just like Job said, God gave me everything I have. And he took it all back. See, it's easy to trust God when you have nothing. At least it was for me. I've been there, all right? At one point, I fit everything I had into the back of my little rusty Ford Ranger, estimated value $1,500, all right? So just this far above nothing, okay, is about what I had. And It's so much easier in that spot to just be like, yeah, God, everything I have is yours, right? But as you grow and as you gain responsibility, as God begins to entrust you with more things and say, here's a wife, here's a child, here's a house, here's a job, here's responsibility, and just begins to hang things on you, all good and proper and right in the course of our lives, right? But as we take each one of those, okay, God, I trust you with this. I trust you with this. I trust you with this. The longer we hold on to it, the more we feel like it's a part of us. And it's mine. And then when God takes it away, we say, why? I worked so hard for that. It's all God's. It all comes from him. It all goes back to him. See, even if your life seems like it's in shambles, we need to trust that God still loves us. Is my daughter in here somewhere? Yeah. Can you bring her up real quick? So many of these passages hit so much harder now that I have a child. And I think about those possessions. Thank you. Hi, bunny. I thought some of you might be losing focus at this point in the service, so I'm doing something about that. She grabs the attention of a room like that. I mean, like, I'll walk through a door, and, like, I used to get greeted like, hey. And now, like, I get greeted like, hi. Hey, how are you today? Right? Is that how it goes? Oh, all right. I think about the things that Job lost. And this has to by far be the worst. Because at the end of the book, God gives him everything back. But if someone were to take my child, another 8-month-year-old girl would not replace her. Never. Never. Are you okay with that? The Bible says that children are a blessing from who? From the Lord. That's right. What's on my face? It's a tough truth. It's a hard truth. I can't imagine losing her, but I have to be okay with it. Because the only reason I have her is because she was given to me by God. And if you can walk through life with that level of trust, with that level of sincerity with your Creator, when bad things happen, you'll also be able to say what Job said. From the Lord to the Lord. Praise his name. But that's the worst part of it. That's the most unpleasant part, right? That God was proving his sovereignty. Nothing more. You shouldn't have to need any other reason. There should be no other answer to your question, why is the unpleasant stuff happening, than that God can do whatever he wants because he's God. Before I move on from this moment, take a second and check your heart, because I know I had to. There doesn't have to be a reason. He's God, you're not. Live with it. Go there. Stand on that hard, cold, uncomfortable rock of truth, that unmoving rock. He's God. But I got to give you some resolution to this, all right? So I think God was also, he had a few irons in the fire in this story, all right? Number one, he was proving he's God. He can do what he wants. He can give, he can take away like that. It's up to him. Don't forget that truth. But there's also some other truths to be learned here. I think God was showing his kid off. Just like we do, all right? Hey, look, my daughter can wave. Can you wave, Jovi? Can you say hi? This is what God was doing with Job. This is what God was doing with Job. He was just saying, look, my servant Job. Look how awesome he is, right? If your kid, like, learns a poem or does a skit, right, or we'll all see him up here on Christmas Eve, right, watch them do their play, we're proud. Showing our kids off, right? Do you want to show off, Job? Daddy show Jovi off? Whoa. How about that? Showing you off, huh? That's what God was doing with Job. He was just showing his kid off, all right? You can take her. Thank you, Jovi. Give her a hand. She did good. Where's that? Oh, over here. There's like 15 of these in unknown places in our house. Just, she chucks them. It's just kind of her thing. So God was showing Job off, all right? And what do we do in those situations when bad things happen, all right? How do we give God glory? Stand tall like Jovi, all right? And go through it and give God the glory. Make your dad proud. Number two, another thing God was working through all of this. I think he was keeping Job from becoming proud. Remember I said Job had a fourth friend? We were going to get to him. It's time. His name was Elihu. And he's not even introduced with all the other friends. He's much younger. And at the end of the book of Job, God says, hey, Job, your friends don't know what they're talking about. None of this happened because of your sin, all right? And God only references those first three friends. He doesn't talk about Elihu, who I believe had a very good response. See, in Job 36, verse 15, Elihu says this, but by means of their suffering, he rescues those who suffer, for he gets their attention through adversity. God is leading you away from danger, Job, to a place free from distress. He is setting the table with the best food. It's hardship, God. It doesn't feel like good food. But you are obsessed with whether the godless will be judged. Don't worry, judgment and justice will be upheld. But watch out, you may be seduced by wealth. Don't let yourself be bribed into sin. Could all your wealth or all your mighty efforts keep you from distress? Do not long for the cover of night, meaning death, for that is when people will be destroyed. Be on guard, turn back from evil, for God sent this suffering to keep you from a life of evil. not because you are in a life of evil, to keep you from a life of evil. I believe this is saying that Job could have been led astray by his wealth, by his possessions, holding too tightly, if this hadn't happened. So that's our second resolution to this as well. But third, and I believe the most impactful, Job learned about the majesty, the sovereignty, the real power of God. Because throughout this book, it's long. I went through the whole thing this past month. There's a lot in there. But Job continues to cry out to God, why is this happening? What are you doing, God? And he just starts to dip his toe a little into questioning God and his motives and his justice. Why, God? And so at the end of the book, God confronts Job in a very powerful way through a mighty windstorm. And he asks him a lot of questions. Questions like, where were you when the foundations of the earth were laid? He asks him, he said, Job, did you give the horse strength? Did you create Leviathan, the mighty creature of the sea? There's actually some really cool descriptions of dinosaurs. Check it out sometime when you get the chance. But God continues to ask Job, like, do you cause the wild goats in the mountains to give birth at the right time? Do you feed the wild oxen and the wild donkeys? Job, do you hold all this together? Who are you against me? God, like he says, so the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways. God is basically saying, like, so if you're here, if your level is here, okay, mine is literally the stars, okay? That's what God was getting across to Job is, listen, like, I am God, right? And so then Job has an amazing response to this. In chapter 42, we're going to go Job 42, verse 1. It says, then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I didn't understand. Things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now and I will speak. I will question you and you will answer me. My ears have heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. Job got to see God. And when you're walking through unpleasant things in life, when you're walking through difficulty, you have the incredible opportunity to know God more. It's not about you, it's about him. God is God. That's all there is to it. And we just have to be okay with that. Think of who you are against him, right? We're here. We're level one, level two, right? God's light years above us in his knowledge, in his comprehension. See, in order to look at a situation and say, why, God? I don't understand. And then to have that thought in your mind, say, this is unfair that this is happening to me. This isn't right that this is happening to me. That's you saying, God, I can see the whole situation just like you can, and it's not fair. And it's just not true. He's so much higher, so much further above us. It's uncomfortable, but it's that truth that's gonna hold you through. You worship a very powerful God. So in closing today, I had a feeling this was going to hit a little hard. It did for me anyway. I want to sing a song for you guys, one that helps me through difficult times and helps me remember that God is who he is. I think some of you may have heard it before, but while I play, just take a moment to think about what God's doing in your life. Think about the difficulties you're going through. Just be okay with it. Just know that he loves you. Know that you might not be able to understand it. And that's all right. Shoot. Close. I did think of that one. But that's a good one. That is a good one. Yeah, you are God alone. That's right. No, this one's a little different. Is it the one in the middle? Is that one? We're good? All right. I'm going to use this mic here.
Trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise? So, Father, we thank you for the hardships. We thank you for your power. And although things may be unpleasant, God, though things may be difficult, we recognize your sovereignty, and we're okay with it. God, we're all right with this not being about us, but being all about you. So when we go through adversity, may we hold our heads high. May we give you honor. May we praise you like Job did. Like the blind man, God, who you healed. May your power be seen in us. Help us stand on that firm, hard rock of truth. Amen. That's it. You're dismissed.
Send His Son, Jesus, and we are made alive.